On this edition for Saturday, August 1st, a key unemployment benefit in the stimulus package expires. The latest on the coronavirus outbreak. And in our signature segment, the state of Oregon's timber industry. Next on PBS NewsHour Weekend.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is made possible by Sue and Edgar Wackenheim III, the Anderson Family Fund, Bernard and Denise Schwartz, the Cheryl and Philip Milstein family, Barbara Hope Zuckerberg, Charles Rosenblum. We try to live in the moment to not miss what's right in front of us. At Mutual of America, we believe taking care of tomorrow can help you make the most of today. Mutual of America Financial Group, retirement services and investments. Additional support has been provided by Consumer Cellular and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people, and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Good evening and thank you for joining us. The emergency $600 a week unemployment benefit that has helped support tens of millions of jobless Americans during the coronavirus pandemic officially expired at midnight. Today, White House officials and Democratic leaders met for more than 3 hours. Both sides said they had made some progress on negotiating a new relief package. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and Senate Minority Leader Chuck Schumer said it was the best discussion the two sides have had so far.
There are many issues that are still very much outstanding where we're apart, but we had a serious discussion and we went down piece by piece and saw where each side is at.
Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin and White House Chief of Staff Mark Meadows also said there were points of agreement as they emerged from the meeting.
It's time to make a deal, and if we're going to be able to succeed in this, it's taking what started as probably the first day of a good foundation of productive discussions and building upon those and until we reach an agreement in hopefully in the next couple of days.
Negotiations are planned to continue tomorrow with staff members and with congressional leaders and White House officials on Monday. For more on the economic effects of the pandemic, including a recent rise in the stock market, I spoke with Diane Swank, chief economist with Grant Thornton via Zoom from Chicago. Diane, broadly, when people hear this horrible news about the big picture of our economy, and then they look over at the stock market and they see the number keeps climbing, where's the connection now between how the economy is doing and how the stock market's doing?
Well, first of all, there is a big disconnect between the drivers of the stock market, just a handful of firms that happen to be benefiting from this horrible environment, pushing it higher. And many of the firms that have been hit hardest are small companies, small businesses that are not even listed on publicly traded companies. So that's one of the issues. Another issue is, of course, that, you know, low interest rates tend to benefit the stock market first. The tools that the Fed has to stimulate the economy are very blunt. And unfortunately, it shows up in the stock market more than it shows up on Main Street. But it is important because you can't have credit markets functioning and have jobs generating as well. So the Fed has to do what it's doing in order to reach those who are hardest hit by this crisis. Yet it does exacerbate some inequalities in wealth out there. And that's something they're becoming very much aware of at this stage of the game.
So much of our economy is propped up by people spending on goods and services. It's not like we stopped eating food. We're still buying the basic things that we need. And for some people, even that's hard. But where have we been spending over this last quarter?
Well, where we saw it, we didn't spend much at all except for on food, really, in April. And as we got into May and June, we saw, you know, as states opened up sometimes too rapidly with the spread of the COVID virus, we saw restaurant spending pick up a bit. We saw spending on clothing really strong. And as we got into June, finally, people backed up on elective surgeries. That really surged spending on healthcare outside of COVID virus, which is important because many people had delayed things during the lockdown. So that came back as well. We also started to see people travel a little bit, spending on accommodations and restaurants of where they were traveling to. Driver miles picked up, gasoline usage picked up, although they didn't do a lot of other kinds of transportation. So you saw slightly some of those things come back that you would expect as you slowly opened up, but a lot of the spending on services was still absent outside of the healthcare sector.
Okay, and here we are heading into a weekend where Congress has not come to an agreement on unemployment insurance and benefits. And for a lot of people, that $600 is a big deal. That even best case scenario, even if Congress miraculously comes to an agreement, it's still going to take a couple of weeks to kick back in.
It's really like falling off a cliff. This is really stunning that Congress has not been able to come together on this issue. Not only did that money provide much needed food and shelter for people, even with all the increases in income we saw and that extraordinary support and stimulus payments, which really were aid payments, a lot of it went to paying for food, people still couldn't pay their rent. So this is really important right now that at the very moment, the moratorium on evictions is expiring and the extra expanded unemployment benefits are also expiring, you're really going to have food and shelter as your biggest hit hardest, where people are already in miles-long food lines. We're talking about the biggest food insecurity and homelessness that we've had since the Great Depression. That's really stunning, and it's already on the rise. We had homelessness rising when we had 3.5% unemployment rate. To think of what we could see in the next couple of weeks is something that's never been seen in anyone's recent memory.
Depending on your politics, all the things that you just said about how bad things are used as a case to try to reopen the economy faster, and they're also used to try to say, let's get a handle on the public health crisis, because that's what's important and that's what's driving the economy, right? It seems a false choice that we really shouldn't have to choose between our health and our economy.
The course of COVID determines the course of the economy. It's so much intertwined and linked together that the Fed chairman, Jay Powell, and the Federal Reserve decided to insert that line into their statement this week when they concluded their meetings, that the course of the economy is dependent on the course of the virus. The economy cannot do better until we bend the curve on COVID. And what we've seen is not only did we pull back before we had one state go into a lockdown. We lost 1.4 million jobs by March 14th before the first state went into lockdown on March 19th because people pulled in because they were afraid of contagion and firms pulled back on their meetings. We're seeing that same exact behavior started in the latter part of June and early July. And the states that are hardest hit by COVID are seeing the largest pullback in spending before they reverse course on openings. And I think that's what's important is fear is a real factor. Our behavior is what drives the economy. And you can't have a healthy economy without having our health.
All right, Diane Swonk, thanks so much.
Thank you.
As leaders in Washington try to work out another economic coronavirus relief package, the U.S. continues to be the epicenter of the global pandemic. There were more than 67,000 new infections yesterday, according to data compiled by the New York Times. On average, daily cases have actually declined by 3% over the past 2 weeks. In total, the U.S. now has more than 4.5 million confirmed infections and 153,000 deaths. Globally, there are 17.6 million infections and 680,000 deaths, according to researchers at Johns Hopkins University. India continues to be a hotspot, recording its steepest one-day spike in confirmed infections yesterday. It has recorded more than 1.1 million infections in July alone and is only behind the U.S. and Brazil in total cases. Today in Germany, thousands gathered to protest coronavirus restrictions. Participants at the event titled The End of the Pandemic, Freedom Day, did not wear masks or socially distance. Germany has been widely hailed for its response to the virus, but in recent days, there has been an uptick in confirmed infections, and officials have warned against complacency in following coronavirus restrictions. One legislator in Germany's governing coalition labeled the demonstrators with the hashtag COVIDiots. President Trump is threatening to ban the Chinese-owned social media video app TikTok, but the company is reportedly offering to sell its U.S. operations to avoid the ban, according to several news reports quoting unnamed sources. The Chinese company ByteDance owns TikTok, which shares user-generated short videos and has as many as 80 million users in the United States. The Trump administration and lawmakers have repeatedly raised concerns that the popular app collects users' data and poses a national security risk. TikTok's general manager of U.S. operations released a video statement today.
We've heard your outpouring of support, and we want to say thank you. We're not planning on going anywhere.
India banned TikTok in late June, along with dozens of other Chinese-based apps, claiming the applications were secretly transmitting users' data to servers outside India. Florida has declared a state of emergency ahead of Hurricane Isaias as it heads toward the state's east coast. The second named storm of the Atlantic hurricane season crossed the Bahamas today with 80-mile-per-hour winds and heavy rain. The projected track shows it skirting Florida's coast starting tonight and through tomorrow. Florida has set up shelters, but officials say evacuations are not likely. The state's largest power company urged customers to be ready for possible outages throughout the weekend and into Monday.
The ultimate track of a storm is unknown, and the center of the storm could remain offshore. But as we said, the tropical storm force winds are likely to cause trees and vegetation that will blow into our lines and will cause power outages.
Visit pbs.org/newshour for the latest national and international news. As Donald Trump campaigned throughout America in the run-up to the 2016 election, he pledged to revitalize some of the country's most iconic blue-collar industries from coast to coast. Then Canada Trump told audiences that their jobs were coming back, including those who worked in Oregon's timber industry.
Timber jobs have been cut in half since 1990. We're going to bring them up, folks. We're going to do it really right. We're going to bring them up, okay?
Before coronavirus restrictions, NewsHour Weekend's Christopher Booker set out to Oregon to learn about the state's historic timber industry and how, if at all, the fortunes of those who work in it have changed.
Watching a tree run through the Southport Lumber Company in Coos Bay, Oregon, is nothing short of remarkable. The process takes about 30 minutes, each tree running through a 21st century production system that would have been hard to imagine just a generation ago. The mill, built in 2005, can process 100 truckloads of raw timber a day, producing lumber and wood chips that are eventually turned into paper products. And while the mill is in every way an extension of Oregon's economic past, it's also a window into why the industry's future is so uncertain for the state's workforce.
So you can see these saws, every time a log comes in, they shift positions, chop the log into shorter segments.
Jason Smith is the manager and one of the co-owners of Southport Lumber Company.
If you look up at the screen up here, it shows a cross section and a profile of the log, what the products we're going to get out of each log, how it's going to be positioned and rotated and presented to the cutting tools to optimize the value of the lumber out of the logs.
The company has invested heavily in technology and automation, and the workforce is much more specialized than a generation ago.
Each board in our mill is scanned with computers. It is optimized, automatically grade stamped by a computer. It's then processed down a sorting line automatically, and it goes to a stacker. So that whole process is done with a couple people, whereas in the past it was done with 10 or 12 people.
This efficiency is one of the reasons Southport has survived when many mills in Oregon have not.
What we've seen in the industry is the same thing that we've seen in most industries in the United States, where if you look long term, we tend to produce the same amount of output with fewer workers.
Mindy Crandall is a professor of forest policy at Oregon State University and studies the state's forest products industry.
When we talk about revitalizing an industry, I'm always really curious what the metric is that people are using. Are we talking about output? Are we talking about employment? Because those two things are very different.
Since the mid-1990s, the amount of timber produced in Oregon has stayed relatively consistent. But during that same period, about half of the state's mills have closed, and nearly 30,000 fewer workers are employed in the timber industry.
A lot of the older, less efficient mills tend to close when conditions are rough, and then the mills that pick up the slack tend to be the newer, more highly efficient, more mechanized mills. Logging has gotten more mechanized. These tend to be good things in the sense that they are indicators of improving U.S. productivity, but it does mean that employment trends down, even if everything else about the industry stays the same.
But there has been a major transition in where Oregon is getting its logs, a change that has deeply divided the state for decades. Nearly two-thirds of Oregon's forests are public, controlled by either the federal government or Oregon, like this state forest. Just 20 miles from Coos Bay, the question for many in the timber industry is whether the trees in these public lands could be used to meet local demand for logs. Between 1989 and 1995, timber harvests on federal land fell by 90%. That's in large part because of the northern spotted owl. It was listed as a threatened species in 1990 under the Federal Endangered Species Act. And as a result of lawsuits and protests, large portions of its habitat in the Pacific Northwest became off-limits for logging, leaving the timber industry to look to private land.
This past year, we've lost 2 mills within our region, and that's largely driven by supply.
Supply of timber?
Yeah, raw wood supply.
Because they just can't get enough?
Correct.
Brennan Geralt is a logging manager with Lone Rock Resources, a timber company that owns 135,000 acres of land throughout Oregon. It employs 105 people, harvesting trees and then replanting them, each one taking decades to get to a point where it can be cut.
You are, within this ecosystem, in an enviable position. You are the ones with the timber.
Correct.
But Geralt says there's a finite number of trees that Lone Rock can cut each year.
We are absolutely sustainable. We manage and harvest, and we have limitations on how much we harvest every year because we are looking at the long-term future of our company. So we can't just all of a sudden cut way more than we're growing.
Lone Rock sells to about 24 different mills, including Southport.
I can't think of any other sawmills that really have the access to the barging infrastructure that we do.
Jason Smith says Southport gets about 10% of its logs from federal land. And with less locally available logs, the company has broadened its supply.
We are buying logs throughout British Columbia. We buy logs in various ports in Washington and have on and off bought logs in California and Oregon ports as well.
But not every mill in the area has managed to stay competitive.
There was 111 full-time employees. 96 of those were hourly and the rest were salary.
And you're the last one?
I'm the last person, yes.
Donald Turner is president of the local machinist union and now the last person to work at Georgia Pacific's mill in Coos Bay. The mill closed last year and Turner now takes care of the grounds.
What did the closure mean for Coos Bay?
Well, there was 111 family wage jobs lost, and then the outlying jobs from there, all the log truck drivers, we would get anywhere from 100, upwards of 100 or more loads of logs a day.
Unlike Southport, the Georgia Pacific Mill only processed one species of tree, the Douglas fir, and the company said cheaper Asian logs made the mill in Coos Bay too expensive to supply. Another piece of the complicated puzzle that is the timber industry, making broad political pledges, like the one Donald Trump made in 2016 to bring jobs back, ever more complicated. Since taking office in 2017, the number of timber jobs in Oregon has been relatively flat.
When you hear politicians reach out to timber workers and say, we're going to bring this back, what goes through your mind when you hear pledges like this?
I'm both a little skeptical and a little sad because I think a lot of rural places are tired of being promised quick, easy fixes. These are what we call wicked problems, right? Forestry is a hugely valuable industry that produces goods that we need and produces a ton of ecosystem services that people also really value. So to say that there's a simple solution to, for example, forcing more employment into an industry that is trying to stay competitive globally, I think is oversimplistic.
Were you surprised when then-candidate Trump came in 2016 and started making overtures to the forest products industry?
I wasn't surprised. I think that the president was looking at opportunities where there is burdensome regulation from the federal government side of things. And if you're looking for a poster child, I think our industry screams. We've been overregulated. If you look at the potential of our lands, they're there. We can support a very vibrant industry, and we're nowhere near where we could be.
Log through the mill. But Jason Smith is not counting on any major change in federal policy.
I don't know how we can ever get to the good old days. I think we've reached a point where we're basically operating on what the private timberlands can produce, and any of the federal timberlands is kind of a bonus at this point.
NASA astronauts Robert Behnken and Douglas Hurley are preparing to begin their return to Earth from the International Space Station this evening. Their historic mission aboard the SpaceX Crew Dragon capsule will mark the first manned launch and return of a commercially built and operated American spacecraft. The Dragon Endeavour has been docked at the space station since May and is expected to splash down tomorrow afternoon. I spoke with Dave Mosher, senior space correspondent with Business Insider, about the astronauts' scheduled trip back home. Dave, there was a lot of excitement when the Dragon capsule from SpaceX took U.S. astronauts up into space, and there's a little excitement on the way down because these capsules are supposed to splash down in the water like back in the old days. What's it going to look like when this capsule re-enters Earth?
What we're first going to see is an undocking procedure, which is the Crew Dragon spaceship moving away from the International Space Station, and then that starts a journey of anywhere from 6 to 30 hours before they actually land back on Earth. We're not going to see a lot of those stages after they leave the space station just because they're in space, but what's going to happen is the spaceship is going to get rid of this trunk, the cylindrical thing full of the solar panels and the fuel and all the stuff, and then it's going to start entering the atmosphere. And shortly after that, we're going to start getting telescopic views of the Crew Dragon coming back. It's going to look like a red-hot kind of white dot in the sky. And NASA's gonna try to follow this all the way to the ground. They're going to deploy the parachutes. We're gonna see those parachutes come out from ground cameras, cameras on boats and in airplanes. And we're gonna see the splashdown in the ocean. And we're gonna see a bunch of boats diverging on that capsule to get those astronauts out of there before they puke their guts out and get them back to recovery boat, get them all checked out by some doctors. And we're gonna see a lot of that footage. And then we're gonna see them whisked away to land via a helicopter from that recovery boat.
So there is a little concern now. Florida is bracing for Hurricane Isaias. What does that do to the weather and the conditions and where the astronauts can land?
Yeah, this is a pretty stunning moment to try to perform a highly important experimental test mission in which you're proving that a brand new spaceship can safely return people to Earth, like take them up to space and take them back to Earth. This hurricane is generating some extremely strong winds, lightning, weather, clouds, all the stuff you don't want. But right now they have several, as NASA says, out of the 7 landing sites, 3 are on the Atlantic side and 4 are on the Gulf Coast side for this capsule to splash down. Right now, Hurricane Isaias is kind of looking to strafe up the Atlantic side of Florida. So we're looking at a possible landing in the Gulf of Mexico at this point.
So how precise can they get on exactly where they want to land? And then how long does it take to get from space to that spot?
So the precision of the landing of this capsule is really good. We saw that with the Demonstration 1 or Demo 1 mission. They basically put it down right where the recovery boat was at. It's just astonishing what a bunch of engineers and aerospace scientists can figure out in terms of the physics and like the wind conditions. They can really nail the landing and pull the boat right up to where the capsule is going to be, which is a good thing. If you're coming back, you don't want to be in that capsule for too long because you're going to get really seasick going up and down on the waves.
So we're going to be able to see this. If they know exactly where it's going to land, are we going to see the capsule with the parachutes coming down and splashing down in the water?
NASA is scrambling basically all resources that it can. It's even called on the Department of Defense to have emergency recovery vessels available. They're gonna have planes in the sky, boats in the water, telescopes even to look for this capsule as it comes through the atmosphere. And it's not just for our viewing pleasure here. They are trying to get as much data as they can about this return because the goal of this mission, the Demonstration 2 or Demo 2 mission, is to show that this capsule is safe to take people to and from space. Not just any people, but civilians. Tom Cruise wants to go up in this with his director, this space capsule, the Crew Dragon, and film a movie at the International Space Station. So they've got to show that this is really safe. And part of that is collecting as much data as they can. So they're going to be recording this out the wazoo, and we're going to be taking a really nice backseat armchair look at this because they're going to stream a lot of that footage directly to NASA TV.
Dave Mosher, thanks so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
That's all for this edition of PBS NewsHour Weekend. For the latest news updates, visit pbs.org/newshour. I'm Hari Sreenivasan. Thanks for watching. Stay healthy and have a good night.
PBS NewsHour Weekend is made possible by Sue and Edgar Wackenheim III, the Anderson Family Fund, Bernard and Denise Schwartz, the Cheryl and Philip Milstein Family, Barbara Hope Zuckerberg, Charles Rosenblum. We try to live in the moment to not miss what's right in front of us. At Mutual of America, we believe taking care of tomorrow can help you make the most of today. Mutual of America Financial Group, retirement services and investments.
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular's goal has been to provide wireless service that helps people communicate and connect. We offer a variety of no-contract plans, and our U.S.-based customer service team can help find one that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
Additional support has been provided by and by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, a private corporation funded by the American people. And by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.